can see, the weather outside is a lot better than last week. Definitely had some horror stories from last week. Highways closed down, and people were trying to get to the session. So we're grateful you're here to set the session this evening. Kind of crazy to think that it's already coming to an end. Next week's our last session. So just two things we want to point out to all of you, we want to touch base on. The business scoring rubric. So we've been updating the business scoring rubric from last week, and we're almost done. It should be out to you by this week, but we just want to stress the importance of when we send that business scoring rubric to you through email, just to make sure that your business plan meets the criteria in that rubric, and that's how your business plan is going to be marked. So make sure to write that down. We will be sending it to you through email. Come on in. Walk behind the screen. So that's really important. And also make sure that your business plan meets the submission guidelines in the participant handbook. Your business plan needs to meet those submission guidelines if it's going to be eligible for marking. So the second part is, there is a really great tool that Bruce Thurston provided for us. It's called the 9 building blocks of the business model canvas. And so this is it's a really great tool. Basically, it helps you to look at the business model canvas and to actually transfer it into the business plan. So I know that some participants have been kind of struggling with that a little bit, actually taking the business model canvas and transforming it into a business plan. So that's on our Facebook page. You'll see it on there. It's at the very top. In a post, the 9 building blocks of the business model canvas. It's also under the resources tab of the Chinook Entrepreneur Challenge website. So just make sure you have that. Okay, so on to tonight here. We just want to go through last week's session. We had Stephen Mogden from Sternum LLP and Tanya Stilson and Nicole Killey, who are actually here tonight, who helped out with insurance last week. So just really briefly, just want one or two comments. What's something that you enjoyed from last week's session? All right, over there.
Just going to sitting down and talking with these two wonderful ladies behind me.
Oh, yeah?
It's rejuvenating and exciting, and I think for our business, my business is right on track.
That's awesome. I'm really glad to hear that. A1 Insurance, fantastic firm. They get you the best deals for your insurance. It's pretty awesome. Great. So
one of the things I hope that you got out of it too is, I think a lot of times we're worried about what questions to ask and we're intimidated walking in the door. So I'm hoping through the partnerships that we bring in that it just makes that connection easier, right? So sometimes when you've met people, you get a contact, it's easy to pick up the door, pick up the phone, or then just stop in and go see them, right? And the same with Stephen. I mean, the whole thought of if I contact a lawyer, et cetera, right? How much is it going to cost me? Will I have to make an appointment? Stephen opens that door on that first thing, so take advantage of it. So.
Hey, Rose.
Yeah, I was looking for an insurance agent, and I learned that I can work in a collaborative relationship with my insurance agent through A1 Insurance.
Awesome.
So that gave me a lot of peace of mind.
Excellent. Great. Okay, moving on here. Okay, so submission deadline. We are going to continue to hammer this into you all so that you know what the submission deadline is. So. Okay, we want to do this in unison. Okay, so the submission deadline is March 28th at 2 p.m. Okay, very good. So make sure that you submit your business plan early. If your files are corrupted and you had it in last minute, it's not going to go through and it's not going to be eligible for marking. So just make sure that you have that submitted early. I can't stress that enough. It's so important. Okay, so tonight, we have Brent Lloyd, who's going to speak to us on operations and competition. He's got a really great presentation tonight. I find it's one of the most interesting parts of the CEC. And we also have Ashley Solms from Madison Young, who is going to give a great presentation on location analysis, which is also an extremely interesting and dynamic presentation for you. Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to pass it off here to Brent Lloyd. He's going to tell us a little bit about himself through his presentation. Let's have a round of applause for Brent Lloyd.
So
Well, so far they've said every presentation that it's the most interesting one, so I'm not sure which one to believe, but it's pretty hard to make business operations as interesting as some of the other ones, but we'll give it a best shot. So last time I did this was probably, it was 3 years ago, and so Jason, who's not here anymore, he said I'd actually, in there, I think their error, but maybe Darlene would argue that, but they had me go first, session one. And so normally I turn a lot of people off of business when I speak. And so we had a massive, we had great attendance in session one. And so when I was asking Jason what he wanted me to present on this time, he said, well, maybe soften it up a little bit. Last time, by session two, half the people didn't show up. Okay, well, we'll try to soften that up. As Stuart said, my name is Brent. I've been involved in various different business operations and things for 25 years, I guess, now. We were talking about the color of my beard there earlier, and I was saying that I ran into a guy I hadn't seen in a while, and he says, geez, dude, you're aging faster than a Commodore 64. So I guess I kind of earned my gray hair a little bit after 25 years. I don't feel like I'm that old. But. So the theme for tonight is confronting the facts. Next 60 minutes, we'll look a little bit about why that theme. I'll try to soften it up a little bit, and operations and management, what that means and what that looks like. So it's kind of tying a lot of the pieces together that you've been talking about through the session or experiencing in your businesses for some of you have been running for a while. And we'll talk about how we're going to apply that to your business plan. A little bit about you guys first. How many, show of hands, how many people this is your first business venture? Okay, by far most of you then. Okay, excellent. Motivation to own a business. How many of you want to make more money? How many is that primary motivation? Okay, 30% of you. Be your own boss. Yeah, you might want to use two hands for this. Yeah, be your own boss. Awesome. Yeah, excellent. Some boss stories there. How many of you think you got a really exciting idea? Good. So you want to make money and you have an exciting idea. I love it. How many of you attended last year? Anybody here last year? One. Okay, and here's a real trick question. How many of you plan to attend next year? Nice. It's not possible to absorb all the information that you're hearing this year and going through the training. So it's a great opportunity to sit in and come back next year, and I don't think there's any reason why you wouldn't want to do that. So think about that. A little bit about me. Background, mechanical engineer. So favorite joke. Normally it's accountants. And I hate to waste it when Bruce is in the room, but I'll use it on myself. But what engineers use is birth control. Anybody heard this one? Personality?
No, not
me. Works better with accountants. So the last 10 years in particular, I've been doing a lot of contract type management, sitting on advisory boards and sitting with companies and working with them day to day on how they get things done, how they understand. And wade through the operational challenges that they have. So I got started in this because of Bruce. I was employed and had just a happy little engineer. And he had asked me to do some consulting work. And I said, well, I don't know that I really have anything to teach anybody or anything to offer. And he says, well, you might be surprised. Why don't you come try it out? And so I took some holidays and did some things and weekend work and evening work. And really got to enjoy it. And then we were both working with the Business Development Bank for a period of time. And covered a lot of ground that way, and saw a lot of different businesses, and it was very intriguing. One of the challenges I had working in a job setting was just the pace. The pace of change was slow. Taking ideas and having them, seeing them through or influencing the folks inside a company, I felt was much harder. From outside the company coming in, I didn't really have a horse in the race, so it didn't matter. If I came in and didn't like the idea, we moved on, and it wasn't a problem. But being on the inside, I found it was a lot harder to influence change and kind of satisfy my need for moving forward and innovating in a business. So the consulting side of things kind of took off for me. They had a speaker there one of the other years I was here. He was a venture capitalist, and he says, if you haven't built one, bought one, and blown one up, you're just a consultant. So at this point, I have not blown one up. So I'm really looking forward. I'm actively pursuing businesses right now, with the sole intent of trying to blow something up, so I can consider myself an entrepreneur, I guess. So, and probably my what makes me what gets me in front of you tonight is just pretty interested in business processes and business efficiency, and it's just the way I think. It's the way I organize my kids' bedrooms. It's the way it just kind of permeates all aspects of life. So that has a strong tie back to how we operate businesses and those kind of things. So and I'm much more operational focused than entrepreneurial. To be entrepreneurial, you really need to be able to evaluate risks, take risks, see opportunities, and recognize the return on investment. And I'm much better at helping other people move the yardsticks in their business than doing it than trying to stick my neck on the line. So I do have a business or two, but they're safe businesses. So and I'm looking to purchase some more businesses, but they'll be safe businesses as well. Is that showing up on there? Can I get rid of that? Or?
Yeah, you can just move it to the side too.
Okay. So before I went on my own, I'd done a lot of project management work and saw the inside of a lot of different organizations. And it was helpful because you don't realize what you're learning until you step away from it. And this was Bruce's point. Come and see how other small businesses operate, see how they, what works and what doesn't work. And just by being around some of these large organizations, you get a sense of what works and some of the processes that are involved in capital planning and approval processes, HR, and various different operational type processes. So that was helpful. I wrecked it. Oh, here we go. So I would differentiate what I do from consulting, and I think this is important to just touch on for you folks, because I'm going to recommend that you involve outside help, and so I'll give you some context around how I see that those definitions a little bit. Consulting is typically when somebody comes in, has expertise in an area, studies what you're doing, gives you recommendations, and ultimately it's up to you to find the resources to implement what they're talking about. And so for the size of business that I'm assuming everybody is in the room, the type of work that I do in Southern Alberta, under kind of in that 5 million and under often is where I'm at for revenues with companies, they don't have the internal resources, they don't have their own internal CFOs. So contracting is a little bit more of an appropriate term for what I do. We've got to come in and design and implement the solutions that we're talking about. We can't just recommend that they do 35 things and go away, because we know that you folks don't have all those internal resources to make all those things happen. So that's where I enjoy coming in and actually seeing the change through. And it's a lot of what Bruce does. Bruce would operate, it's typical to do different engagements on different levels. Bruce does a lot of consulting as well, but he would also come in a contract fashion and get things done, design a spreadsheet, move the yardsticks for the business. And from a pure contracting example, you don't want to hire a plumber who's going to come in and tell you how to make the toilet flush. When a plumber leaves, you want the toilet to flush. And that's kind of the metaphor for us. A big part of what I do, and I'm suggesting that you guys do as well, is bring in the skills that you need when you need them. We're going to talk more about this, but folks like Bruce, so when we go into engagements, not all of us are on our own, and so when we need to go in and if we need expertise that we don't have, we can draw on them, or the clients can draw on those resources. It's a very efficient model. It's a very easy way to get expertise in an area that you don't have to have on payroll. So that's really what we do. And there's various different outlets to access those kind of resources, but you've got a lot of names and a lot of folks here that you've met. Be able to contact them. My office, I've got my first office was open 1964. Right now I've got 15 offices in Lethbridge. Same office as Bruce. Some of my best and worst ideas have happened in my offices. Very portable, very, very portable. Happy to meet you at any one of my offices anytime if you need any advice. One of the meetings I had at this Tim Hortons, a fellow from this, it was about 5 years ago, had an idea and he was going to supplement his job. So his idea of running a business was supplemental income and not to take over his day job. So he was kind of laying out the financial aspect of what he was going to do. And I said, so what do you make now? And so it was, say it was $20 an hour. And he figured that by his calculations, he was going to do about $30 an hour. And instead of a coffee at Tim Hortons, we figured out he's probably going to be closer to about $6 to $8 an hour with his after-hour endeavor. And so it made sense to work a little bit more overtime at his day job and maybe scrap the idea of the side business.
So this is where I got myself into trouble in years past. I think we do a disservice to everybody in the room if we tell you that you're all going to be successful entrepreneurs and you should all start a business. It just isn't the case. It just statistically isn't the case. However, I think there's great value in going through the process. Even if your current idea is not the one that's going to be a viable business, you're learning the process, you're involved in it, you're deciding you're going to be in a position to decide whether or not business is for you or not, regardless of what business idea you have now. Anybody heard of James Stockdale? Anybody read the book Good to Great? Yeah? It's James Stockdale was the highest ranking officer in the U.S. military that was a prisoner of war in the Vietnam War. I was just saying to Stuart that I did a bunch of traveling when I was his age. I was encouraging him not to sweat finishing his degree, just get out and see the world a little bit. So I went to the Hanoi Hilton in Vietnam, so I saw where he was held captive for years. And so he was interviewed by Jim Collins, the author of Good to Great. And he was asking me, he says, so how did you survive? How did you get out alive? He says, you had to have, it was a paradox. He says, the people who didn't come out alive were the optimists, the ones that said, we're going to be out by Christmas. This is going to get easier. This is going to get better. He says, ultimately, they died of a broken heart. So his point was, you've got to have such a stoic resolve that you're going to succeed, and at the same time, have the ability to confront the brutal facts of your current reality. So businesses will kick you when you're down. It's like coaching hockey in Canada. If you don't have thick skin, don't coach youth hockey and don't go into business, because it will kick you when you are down. So that's the theme for today, confronting the facts. I want to draw on that a little bit, because confronting the facts is also, it'll tie back to your plan, because what really needs to happen for your plan and this competition, but then more importantly, the success of your business, is it needs to be realistic. Anybody know what the number 15 represents? You can't know, because I made it up. It's the number of times that the word realistic or unrealistic appears in the rubric. Show of hands, how many people have ever heard the word rubric before this competition? Current students, maybe, is that why? I've never heard of the word. Apparently that's
it's
the...
French.
Is it really? That would make sense. Anyhow, so your plan, in order to score top points in your plan and be in the running for the $10,000, is you have to have a realistic plan, and that's what we're going to talk about today. Any questions so far? Thoughts? Nobody's getting up and leaving yet. So then when I said to Darlene, I said, yeah, Jason cautioned me not to be so aggressive and scare people off. She goes, oh, no, don't do that. You got to keep
realistic.
It. Be realistic. Well, now you tell me. I kind of took all the good stuff out. So operations. Operations is going to be a term that you'll probably never really define the same way depending on what kind of business you're in. It depends on the business size and structure that you have. Management, operations, all words that will be applied differently. I'm not going to get too hung up on the definition. For our purposes, though, it's going to be smaller businesses, mostly startup businesses. I want to have it applicable to the business plan. And so like we talked about with the rubric, we have criteria that we want to meet, so I want to draw on that a little bit. So I'm going to focus on that more so than maybe if I had a one-on-one conversation with you, how I'd see that conversation. So very simply, you've got to convert time and or materials into goods and services. You need to do that as efficiently as possible. What else? Cost effectively as possible. You've got to maximize your profit. And here's the big one. You get to do all of that with very, very limited resources. Extremely limited resources. So we're going to talk a little bit about that as well. So with the canvas in mind, how many people have got the canvas nailed down? Everybody got it figured out? Anybody confused by it still? I'm kidding. It's a lot to learn. It's a simple model, but there's so much behind it. It's a very intriguing, very interesting way. What we hope that you'll come away with this from this is that you have a way of thinking about business that you can start to compartmentalize things into a process and how those blocks tie together. And that there again, coming through the process again next year is only going to help cement that learning as well. But there's a lot of complexity in everything you've talked about, and it's not uncommon for that you go from a basic understanding to a point of confusion, and hopefully to a point of mastery. And I think everybody will be different on this curve. This is how I maintain it as far as my university career. I was a C student, or less. Because I figured I was still, in terms of progress, I was further along than the B students, but I was at that point of confusion because I was overanalyzing everything. I should have just taken everything at face value, got a B, but I'm not programmed that way. And I was never an A student. So a big part of this in going from having a basic understanding to that point of confusion, you have to recognize that as being progress. If you simply, because the school, the world would have you believe that going from a B to a C is not progress. But what, for the paradox, the hills of knowledge, it came from the book How. You have to recognize that as progress. And it's really important in business, because when you're down and you're being kicked, you have to recognize that as progress. I've had this conversation with a lot of different folks. I've had opportunities to sell businesses. And I had one of the buyers just kind of say it to me, he says, why don't you hang on to it for a while? It's really not as bad as you think it is. And he says, I honestly, my advice is hold on to it and wait a few years and sell it to me in a few years. I thought that was really sound advice. But you're going from an unconscious ignorance to a conscience, conscious ignorance. And that's applicable in a lot of areas of life, but just very, very much so in business. You are now starting to uncover and peel off some of the layers of the onion, where you're saying, boy, this is what I'm up against, this is what I don't know. It can be a little bit uncomfortable. So let's simplify it a little bit. This is credit to Bruce as well. I really like this this terminology. Really bring it to the basics. You need to, as your business, as a business owner, you need to get work, you need to do work, and you need to manage work. It's very, very powerful. The simplicity of it is just beautiful. Your plan needs to come down to some very, very basic language and make sure it answers these three questions. Have I communicated to the reader that I can get work, do work, and manage work? So failing to manage. Anybody complete that sentence for me? 80% of businesses fail.
First 5 years.
Everybody heard that before? I think it's probably pretty accurate, probably more so, probably higher than that. Anybody know what happens to the 20% that survive?
They adapt.
No. They adapt, yep, you betcha. Yep. They survive, for sure. Is surviving succeeding?
No.
Anybody know anybody stuck in their business? Bruce, do you know anybody stuck in their business?
Many.
What does stuck look like, Bruce?
Stuck look like you have no way to get out.
And why don't you have a way out?
Because no one's interested in your business, or you're in debt too much, and you don't look eligible, and you aren't making enough money to entice a cash flow for somebody to be in your business.
A very high number of businesses that survive do not succeed, and the definition of success is you've got to be making more money than your day job, because you will have more stress, you will have risk, you will have your flexibility likely won't be there. We heard from Ram a couple sessions ago about his restaurant businesses. So I went out and had a beer with him in Picture View a couple of weeks ago and chatted with him some more. That he was very aware. He had the conversation. Sadly, he had the conversation with his wife about vacation. Do you want to take vacation now or when we retire? And that is an unfortunate question and an unfortunate reality for a lot of folks in business. Anybody here know any other people stuck in their business? Often it's debt that gets you stuck. You owe money and you got to keep plugging away. But I would hate for you guys to open a business and make less money than your current day jobs. That you have to set your sights higher than that. So, back to our simple analogy. Businesses fail when one or more of these are missing. So if you fail to get work, your death is quick and painless. You don't really, I mean, unless somebody gives you some, unless somebody gives you money on you know, I guess love money could be a problem. You might not be able to talk to your parents anymore. If you're able to get work, and for some reason someone convinced you to go into business and you can't do the work, that tends to be a little bit longer, and there's going to be more pain involved. Where it really gets interesting, and this is where you get stuck, is if you can't manage the work. So if you are getting a ton of work and you can do the work, chances are you're not going to keep up with the work, you're going to fall behind, you're going to have customers cancel. Managing your cash flow, understanding that as business grows, cash goes down. I don't know if it's entirely a universal truth, but it's pretty darn close. If you grow your sales, it takes cash. It takes more cash to grow. You need all three. We're going to talk a little bit about that today. Bruce, you want to add anything to that?
No, I've just discovered my cataracts are worse because I can't read what's in the red boxes.
Oh, no, neither can I. Sorry, it's nice and bright on my screen. You get the idea. Got to have all three. So putting it another way, if you're not getting work, you're going to lose your startup costs, some minimal operating costs. If you're failing to do work and keep up with the work that you've sold and committed to customers on, you're going to have warranty issues, you could have legal issues, so it starts to escalate a little bit. Failing to manage the work, now you've got all kinds of things. You've got the bank, you've got family, and you've got the reality that you will be tempted to borrow money from a Jimmy. And Jimmy has a way of coming ahead of the bank when it's time to collect. Anybody here from Tabor? Yeah? There's Jimmys out there. I did some work up in Tabor. You borrow money from people that think you think it's a good idea because you believe. What did Craig talk about? Having you're in love with your idea, you're in love with your solution, and so you borrow money, you think it's a sure bet. Well, they come looking, and the stress of paying a guy like that back is higher than the bank. So very few businesses fail because they can't do the work. You're not going to start down the path if you, at very minimum, can't do what it is you're setting out to do. So that's not why they fail. Businesses will fail when they're not managed properly, managing all the different aspects. I often think about, when I'm meeting with clients, I think of a wheel with spokes, and if you have a spoke on the wheel that's unusually long or unusually short, so if you are unusually strong at something or you're missing some skill sets in your business, it's going to be a rough ride. And so the importance about with business is you want to have things grow at the right rate. You want to have all the spokes in the wheel working together. And that's tricky because you will, in your own skill set, be better at some things and not in others. So we're going to talk about shoring those up a little bit. So why is this doing the work? Put another way, doing the work tends to be a fairly sexy thing, especially when you love your product or your solution. It's kind of a sexy thing to deliver that to the customer. This is always one that gets me. Getting the work, doing the sales, the marketing, it's always the sexiest part of doing business. Doing what Bruce and I do, which is managing the work, quite simply, it's just not sexy. And that's why it gets left, it gets ignored, the skill set's undervalued or even misunderstood, and businesses start to struggle because they don't have the skills in the not sexy and the unsexy part of the business. So, taking this forward, any questions so far? Now that you know I'm an expert on sexy. Elements of the business plan. So these are three areas that I'm going to just touch on.
Watch the time here too. What time am I down?
45 minutes.
So, three elements of the business plan that I think we'll touch on here, and I want to make sure that at very minimum you have these elements in there. So this is going to be part of the rubric, three elements of them. And so I'm going to speak specifically to what the judges are going to be looking for. It's not necessarily, it's like financial statements. You want to have one that you give to CRA and pay less tax. You want to give one to the guy that's trying to buy your business and inflate your income. And then you have the other one, which is the actual one of how you run and how your business actually looks. Same kind of thing, your business plan, you have a co- your business plan for the purpose of the competition needs to satisfy the scoring criteria. And so that's what we'll talk about today. It's even less sexy than the unsexy part of the business. So. Team. Team is a big one. This is an area that there's some really powerful things that you're learning just by virtue of you being here. You're far ahead of a lot of your competitors or other folks in the 80 and the 20 that do survive in business. Org chart is going to be a key piece that you want to have in there. And the org chart is a simple tool, but it's a powerful tool. And I want to draw a couple of things out that I want to make sure nobody makes these mistakes. So the basics, including all your full and part-time staff, but also your advisors, your mentors, your partners, any kind of subcontract support, make sure that's on there, because that's going to tell the reader that you have resources more than just the ones you can afford to have on staff. Separate the roles, not the people. You will more than likely, I mean, every business is going to have your typical 10 roles between everything from IT support to HR support to safety to you're going to be everything in your business. So it seems a little redundant to do a business plan with you in all the boxes. Similarly, it's unadvisable to have a business plan that just has one box and one name on it. It doesn't show the reader that you understand how business works. So create a plan, and I'll show you a sample, where you have all the roles that need to function in your business are there. Start with those boxes, then fill in the names. It'll do a number of different things. We'll get to those. Anybody here use Visio before? It's kind of a handy tool. There's other apps and things that I'm not aware of that I've never used, but there's lots of different ways to use flowcharts, organizational charting type software and apps so that you can capture information in an efficient way, because you're limited on page numbers, so you want to communicate as much as possible in this plan very efficiently in your business plan. So Visio is one. I just made a note of it there.
MindJet's another.
What's that?
MindJet?
Yeah, there's a whole bunch out there. Like, just the old school. I come from the Microsoft Office suite, so PowerPoint, all the basic ones, right? But a lot of folks now use different and better and more applicable apps and free. And so there's lots out there, but there's no excuse to do it on pen and paper or even using Excel for that matter. So building your team. Really communicate this in your business plan. Who is the team? Because largely, if you stop and just do it, maybe the traditional way, you would have you and your banker and your accountant, and that would be it. There's far more resources that you've been exposed to now through these sessions, and you're starting to see the benefit and some of the breakdown of different roles and skill sets that are available through these folks. Make sure you include those folks in your business plan. Even associations and memberships, any kind of business groups or collaborations that you're part of, any paid advisors or any other experts. We talked a little bit about this earlier, but paid advisors and hiring expertise, don't get too taken up in the price tag. I have a few companies here in town that I have a virtual CFO on staff with them. So it's a fella that used to do a bunch of business training through Alberta Treasury Branch and different groups. He's based out of Seattle, but he's the CFO for three of my clients here in Lethbridge. So he meets with them once a month by phone. He reviews their books. He holds them accountable to what they've set for their plan each month, asks questions if anything's out of line, and forces you to have a rigid month end so that you're actually doing what you should be doing in your business. He costs about $400 an hour, works out to be about $1,000 a month, and that's great value to have a high-priced, high-powered individual like that pouring over your books. And those people are available, and they're out there. See if you can tap into that. Of course, we can put you in touch with them, but tap into that expertise, and don't be so quick to dismiss a $400 an hour price tag if it's only an hour a month that you need. There's some great value out there. And I think that's the point, though. Of course, the value needs to exceed what you're paying for it. mentors, you get to getting great exposure to a lot of folks who will offer you information for free, also known as a mentor. Bruce gives tirelessly to folks in a mentorship capacity, which is really a mark of character. There's lots of folks who really enjoy meeting with people who are just getting into it and helping them along the way. At the same time, don't be too quick to pay for expertise if there's a mentor available. But they're not free. Always show your appreciation, whether it's a Tim's card or in whatever way. I try to, in the first meeting with somebody who's given me a hand with something, and then you know you're not going to be able to pay them, they're not looking for anything, try to get to know something about them in the span of the conversation, who their favorite author is or whatever, and give them something that shows that you appreciate and that you're listening. It doesn't have to cost you a lot, but those mentors will stick around when they know that you appreciate what you've done for them. Include them on your report chart.
Brent, I heard you bought a motorhome.
Do you want to borrow it? I live in a mobile home. My wife is super patient, and the only thing she wanted was a motorhome. When I proposed to her, she didn't cry. When we had children, she didn't cry. When I bought her a motorhome, she cried. And I don't know what to make of that. I don't know what I did wrong, but that's really what we've reduced our relationship down to. The only thing to make her happier than living in a mobile home is another home on wheels, another depreciating asset. So one thing I'm allergic to is depreciating assets. And I was just telling Darlene that I was trying to simplify my life, and you went out of me. So this would be an example of an org chart. Make room. It doesn't necessarily have to be a traditional org chart, but make room to put in your key partners, your key suppliers. Bring that relevance back to the business model canvas. Who are these folks? Demonstrate to your lenders, in this case the plan, the competition judges, that you understand you need the support, you have the support, your chance of success in business is going to go up significantly. One of the other trends right now in org charts, I don't know if it's a trend, it's what I like to do when I do an org chart for any company, I invert it. So you as an owner or a president is on the bottom, customer is on the top, and the visual significance of that is that you're not lording over the organization as the president looking down on your whole organization. You have the entire weight of the organization on you. Your job is to support the organization. Very fundamental difference. And anybody that balks at that or needs that is an ego-driven kind of CEO that wants to be at the top, I just don't work with. Just simply put, those kind of folks don't interest me at all. If you're not there, if you don't view your role as having to shoulder the entire weight of the organization, then it's you're a little bit misled on what your role is in the business. I was missing something there. I can't remember what it was. I was going to say. Questions on the org chart. Has anybody done their org chart? Have anybody got this far yet? No? Okay. Put the roles in that you know you need. So all of these boxes, you're typically going to have most of them. I mean, I don't know that I would put reception in there necessarily if you don't have receptions. But someone's got to answer the phone. Someone's got to handle customer inquiries. So put all of that on there. A couple of things will happen. You'll be amazed at how many hats you're wearing in the business. And it'll also become a tool down the road where you can say, boy, how many hours a day am I spending in each one of these? I did a job at the university here. It was an insurance job, and I was leading an engineering team because the library was sinking while it was settling. And so I had to work with an insurance group, and they gave me a copy of their timesheet. And what I had to do was make a tick. Every 5 minutes was a tick. Every time I touched a file or talked to anybody, I had to put all these ticks. And that became my billing system. And so at the end of the day, you had no idea how many things you did until you started keeping track with little ticks on a piece of paper. Same kind of thing here. You have all these roles. You really have no idea where your time is going. I've never yet met a client that tells me how they divide their time. And then when we actually keep timesheets and do the tick system for a couple of weeks, it never agrees with what they think they're spending 80% of their time on. So it's really interesting tool. So what you'll find is that, boy, maybe it is time to hire someone to answer the phone. Maybe it's time to hire a safety person. It's a great tool for that as well. We talked about not having, you know, you as an owner, be careful in having yourself, you're going to wear a couple different hats for sure. The one that you don't want to confuse if you have other folks in your business is your owner hat. Your owner hat is on when you're doing ownership type things. But for the most part in your own business, you're not wearing the owner hat. You're wearing the role that you're doing at the time. And when you start having your owner hat on all the time, it can be very destructive to the organization. Bruce had mentioned my wife has Green Acres Animal Hospital. And so she's a veterinarian and she loves just fixing animals. And so I try to take care of most of the other things in the business from a general management standpoint. And so we have a general manager there, so I'm really not needed there at all. I go in for a few meetings a week. But I can't go there every day. If I go there every day, that's so disruptive and destructive. The morale goes down. It's not productive. And it's because I'm going through and I have trouble taking that hat off and not picking on things that aren't done and thinking and acting like an owner when I'm acting outside of essentially the org chart. So it can be destructive. I know it firsthand. Questions on the org chart? So implementation plan, the way that it's laid out in the material that you've got is intentionally simplistic. It's meant to be a starting point. Everybody here can do better than what you've been given. So there's different ways of communicating that information, but ultimately what you're trying to do is demonstrate to the reader that you have a sequence of steps that you're going to follow, and you understand how long they're going to take, who's going to do them, and you're not missing critical things in the implementation of your business. So anybody here heard of a Gantt chart, seen a Gantt chart before? Yeah, a few of you? So this is an example of a Gantt chart. Does that show up okay? And really what it is, it's a project management tool, but it's great for so many different applications. This is another example of a software. This is Microsoft Project, but you can find other ones online that are simple to use and available at less cost. This was, and I didn't see this layout in the material this year, but last time I was involved, there was kind of a breakdown of all the different things that you needed to do to get your business off the ground. So this kind of thought process where you list all the tasks, how long are each of these tasks going to take? 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks? Some of them can overlap and happen at the same time. Some of them you need a week in between. But ultimately, it's a way to lay out everything that you need to be doing. And it creates a horizontal chart that are connected and linked, it's called, so that you can have an idea of what is a critical path, what things need to get done. If you're delayed a week on something, is that going to affect startup and when you're going to start generating sales and when you can start paying the bank back? So this would be an example of a startup. What are the startup tasks that you're looking to do? But then I would encourage you to go to a 1 year or even a 5 year type of a plan as well. Always have kind of an implementation plan in the background. This is another tool that communicates a ton of information very efficiently in a business plan. Very difficult to communicate a lot of this information any other way. The chart that you have in your material is quite simplistic, and you wouldn't get near this detail on there, and you certainly wouldn't convince the reader that you know your stuff really well. Any thoughts, questions on that? So that's the second section of the plan. So the operations plan, getting into the word operations, this is really going to be, I'm going to show you how we run operations at the animal hospital. I'm going to show you a tool that we use. It's probably not going to be where you're going to be in the first year, but it gives you an idea where it's going. For the purpose of the plan, what the judges are looking for, we're going to touch on three areas. So key activities, location of facilities, which what was your name again?
Ashley.
Ashley is going to touch on in detail here after me, and then equipment and resources. So key activities, after you get work, what do you have to do, going back to the canvas, what do you have to do to turn that good or that time and material into a good or a service? What are those processes? What are those steps? Invariably, people will underestimate them. And if they do get all the steps correct, the cost that they attach to them is often very, very underestimated. So it's efficiency is a big part of it. Everybody assumes that they're going to produce at 100% efficiency. That's never the case. The more you can communicate what activities you're doing, how much time it's going to take, and include some cushion in there so that if you can make 1 in 10 minutes, it means you can do 6 in an hour, and it means you can do 48 in an 8-hour day. Yeah, you got to allow for some things in there. Show the reader that you understand realistically what's going to come in between you producing at that efficiency. In billable time type service industries, so in my world, if you're billing 80% of your hours that you're working, that's excellent. You can make great money if you can. I've got folks in billable time industries where they're billing 300% of their hours. And that's back to the tick system. Every 5 minutes, you might have spent a minute, but you write it down for 5. And you can bill more than the 8 hours in a day. But very few businesses get this right. It's always optimistic. What happens to optimists? They die, remember? There's wooden wedges under their fingernails. So key activities. So this would be an example of some steps that you'd go through. Just simply ordering, receiving, processing what you need to do, shipping, and warranty. Demonstrate that you can walk through the process of what it is that you're doing, a good or a service, and lay out each step, describe what it is that you're doing, what happens when parts are late or wrong, because it's not going to be perfect. Your tendency in writing a business plan will be idealistic and optimistic, and you will assume everything's going to work well. Demonstrate to the reader that you know things are not going to go perfect. This is another opportunity where you can demonstrate that. Shipping, there again, channels, and this is, all ties back. You can see the relevance back to the business model canvas. Warranty and things like that are going to be inevitable. Either rework or meals that were wrong, or somehow you're going to be on the hook for costs. So there's going to have to be something built into your financial plan that include things like bad debt when people don't pay. Demonstrate to the reader that you have a realistic idea, even if you're not going to be profitable. The goal isn't to be able to demonstrate that you're going to be profitable in the first year. Demonstrate that you know what you're doing. You can make a decision if you want to get into it and wait 3 years to be profitable. That's not uncommon. But showing the reader that you think you're going to be profitable in the first year, when it's clear to the reader you're not going to be, is going to cost you. It's going to cost you in this competition, but it's going to cost you in business, more importantly. Location and facilities. This is one I've talked to Darlene a little bit about as well, and Bruce. Lots of examples of people who underestimate the costs of a facility and a location. Very simply, you have leasehold improvements and some kind of fit up that you're going to do to the space. It doesn't come cheap. It generally takes longer and more money than you anticipate. And if you're looking at it as an optimist, that's going to be worse. Minimize. I mean, it's a simple calculation: the number of square feet times the rate. It adds up very quickly. And of course, the less space you have, the cheaper insurance, right, Tanya? If you can co-locate and just have tenants' insurance, it's even cheaper. Really, the goal is to minimize your insurance. Pay as little insurance as possible. There's the invitation. Everybody heard about motivation, motivated sellers, motivated buyers. Even if you are one, act like you're not. When you go to the table, you don't have much to negotiate if you're motivated. When the salesman knows that your wife wants a motorhome more than she wanted to get married. Yes?
Salesperson.
What's that?
Salesperson.
Exactly. Occupancy costs are always underestimated. There's always more there. You forget that someone still has to shovel the snow. You forget that utilities might go up in cost. You forget that it might not be a perfectly efficient building. Leasehold improvements has been a big thing. Darlene, you want to mention something about that? What have you found?
That's probably the biggest thing that we find most of our clients run into, right? They go out, they find a space that they really want. They so underestimate, or they get quotes. My guess is they probably don't get more than one or two, and how do we get them to stay on top of that? So we've had clients who are 6 to 8 weeks, sometimes a couple months behind, because they, contractors, they start out great, and all of a sudden they get a bigger job, so then they're not showing up at your office. Not long ago, we had one of our clients at the grand opening. They had their grand opening about 5 months after they had actually, you know, had planned. And as people were showing up for the grand opening, the contractors were rushing to get their tools and stuff out of the way. We've also had a client not long ago was like 7 months, so they're making loan payments. They're 7 months and they're not open. We also have probably one of our most heart-wrenching clients that we absolutely to this day love, and she got tied up in the concept of having the most beautiful business out there. And every time the contractor or designer said, well, but if we did this, it would just be like, it would belong in a magazine. Well, belonged in a magazine, but she couldn't afford to do it after, so she ended up losing it all. So be very, very conscious. You can grow in and you can, you know, you can start basic and then just do things to be on top of it. Maybe control your money, because it's the easiest thing to spend a ton of money on that you don't need, because we all want big, beautiful, and shiny. So be careful.
Anybody want to share an example of what they're doing now with the location or facility?
Well, I'll just share. When we bought Boca Cabana, we leased for the, we just bought the building, but we weren't even in the building 10 days, and we leased it as is, and the water system blew. And we knew that the water system would need to be changed because it wasn't really gonna work. And then we bought what we like to call the toaster blew the electrical. They were using just Walmart toasters, and we bought a commercial toaster, and it blew the electrical system. It wasn't prepared to handle that little bit, one little bit extra. Mm-hmm. So we've done a lot of leasehold improvements that we hadn't planned on.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And those always come at the most inopportune time.
Very first week in business, yeah. You've just put everything into buying the business.
So and that speaks to a bit of contingency as well.
You definitely, I would say, have contingency. I'm so glad that we did.
We did, and but we could have used more.
Yeah, so always could use
that
more.
Scenario could play out in the sense that you're tapped right out and something happens in the first day of business and sets you back, and now you're going to the angel investors, right? You're going to mom and dad, you're going to whoever you can find to cover that in some cases, and that's where the spiral starts, right?
We didn't have to do that, but Ashley, if you don't mind, we're on a triple net, and from what my understanding is, a lot of landlords do triple net. And can we talk about that today?
It's a basic version of triple net, whether it's the same as gross or not, but the landlord's responsible to cover the maintenance and the insurance and the taxes on the building. Part of your lease goes into those costs. So.
And that's where we got into trouble. We
yeah.
thought that was normal, and we're told that's normal, and then all of a sudden everything was our responsibility and it didn't work.
Yeah.
Unless it was
when you get into a space, anything is on your walls and the interior is your responsibility. The toilet plugs, your responsibility, right? If the water heater goes or the HVAC system on the roof, different story. So.
But it still requires the landlord to step up and do it. Because the landlord's not the one not making money.
We gotta have more
right?
water.
And so that's only as good as your ability. So oftentimes you just need to get it done and then you fight about who's gonna pay for it later, right?
That's right. That's what happened. That's what we had to do.
Yeah.
So I hope that's what you're looking for.
Yeah, no, that's great. Great example.
Yeah, so this is basically your responsibility for paying the bill. What is the other end where it's the landlord's responsibility? What's that called? Paying maintenance or things like that?
Well, and maybe you can talk more about that in the location side of things. And
I was just going to mention, I work from home, but when I meet with clients, we now have three opportunities for working in town. And so when I actually have to meet somebody and want to have a professional space, then it's the port
it's
where
work,
I'm
yeah.
going, and
yeah.
they're expanding. And so that's a really nice way to have a professional space, but not be putting up.
Yeah, pay for it when you use it, and not. I've struggled with that a lot. It's
yeah.
it's time that I leave my own nest as well, and I just it's a hard pill to swallow, right? It's, is there a question back there or comment?
So
storefront. I'll do a shameless plug here too. So I mean, if by some chance your business is going into the downtown BRZ as well, so Community Futures, we work with this heart of the city and the BRZ, and so we can do business improvement loans up to $15,000 interest free for those type of leasehold improvements as well. So if you're going into the downtown core, come see us.
Okay. Good. Can we get any more plugs in for insurance up there?
Oh, I just want to say go see my husband.
Yeah. Oh, no, there you go.
On the both sides. Yep.
Perfect. Excellent. So with your plan, as far as location facilities, make sure that you define exactly what you need and how you're going to operate. Anytime you can be collaborative and be creative and keep those costs down, it really is key to, it might be that you can afford a space, but can you afford when the electrical system fails or all the other things that go along with being a tenant or an owner. And get all the costs in there. Very often things are missed, and these are big ticket items, and they're very, they hurt if you miss them, and you've got to find that money somewhere. So every step of that, again, in your implementation plan, demonstrate that you, if you've got to get set up, if you've got to get a special electrical service set up, any of those things. We had, when we renovated the animal hospital, we had a architect that does nothing but vet clinics out of Albuquerque. The first question they asked was, do you want the wow factor or do you want practical? What are you looking for so that we design within your budget? And I thought that was really clever, because that's the way the owner thinks. The owner's not thinking in terms of the type of finishes, but the architect asked a question in a way that was really simple for us to answer, right? We're not looking for vaulted ceilings, we're looking for basic, clean, practical kind of application. And that having that plain language conversation with your contractors is important.
Sorry, I have a quick question.
Yes.
With regards to your last comment on that last slide.
Yep. I think if it's a true reflection of how you're operating, the one thing I would caution you on is that it, as you grow, is that model still going to serve you? From a tax standpoint, of course, you still claim all of that. Don't take that out. But I think you could claim it on your against your income, right? Your household office. So it doesn't hurt to have that attached to your business as well as a cost. But either way, as long as it's realistic.
Thank you.
Equipment, same kind of a concept here. Everything that you're going to need it should be documented, should be laid out. If you have a line item that just simply says equipment, very difficult for the reader, for the screener, to appreciate what that means. And equipment could be office equipment, it could be processing equipment, whatever that is, cooking and kitchen equipment, whatever it is that you need. And this is always an area that is underestimated as well, because you're going to buy used, you're going to find things cheap. Invariably, it'll always cost you more. Anytime you can look at a partnership and try to share, I'm a big fan of fractional ownership. There was a time where I owned nothing on my own. My kids' dirt bikes I shared. Everything I could possibly own fractional, I did. From a business standpoint, I put like Hutterites as an example in there. There's people out there that have fantastic equipment and different things that you can outsource at a great rate. And the appeal of having the convenience of having your own equipment in some cases doesn't make sense in the first few years. Anybody got examples of equipment that they're sharing or borrowing or in their business or plan to keep some costs down?
You know, Brent, we had it used to cost us $1,000 a quarter to shampoo the rugs in our restaurant. So we ended up buying a shampooer for $4,000, and we timed it well. We would give the employees the beer after the shampoo was done. Having said that, in a year it was paid for. And the following year, we ended up shampooing before other restaurants and billing them $1,000
yep.
each time we did it.
Perfect. Yeah, and those little wins that early on, and it's always a balancing act between what your time is best spent doing yourself or outsourcing it. But looking for opportunities that way to take a piece of equipment and just maximize the return on it, it's a great idea.
And outsource your IT.
Yep.
Cloud based. Mm-hmm. You can go Amazon or anything like that. It's all a fraction of the cost.
Yep. IT is a great one. We've gone to working with Maxim Management with a couple of companies right now. Anybody know Obed? He was the top 40 under 40. So he's another example, a little bit more of an extreme example of outsourcing. So we've outsourced all of our bookkeeping and our accounting out to a remote. One time I had met with one of his accountants. She just says, "Good to meet you." And I said, "I guess that's right. We've never met face to face. We've been working together for a year and doing Google Hangouts and things. I've never met her." Outsourced everything to them. They took over everything in our business, and nowadays technology allows you to do that much more so. So on your plan, though, make sure that's detailed out. Give for your sake and for the screener's sake, make sure that you identify everything that you're going to have there. I want to show you something here now quick. So this is an example of a software that we use at the vet hospital. So this is now, everything that we do is, not everything, I shouldn't overstate it. Most of what we do is systemized. And so all of our operating processes are contained in what's called four key functions. So for the purposes of today, we're not going to talk about how we guide the practice, but getting work, doing work, managing work. So the entire tool is set up around that very basic language. And this is a tool, anybody here read, the E-Myth? Yeah? If you haven't, get it. It's a must read. E-Myth Revisited is what it's been called now for quite a while. Author is Michael Gerber. So this software came out of, they also have a consulting division within E-Myth. So you get on a call with them once or twice a month and they walk you through systemizing your business. And what happened was there's a problem between everybody telling you, well, go out and systemize your business, capture all your workflows, capture your checklist, do all your policies, procedures, have everything in place. But there's not really a great tool for that. Really the only tool, and I've been on this one for quite a while, but prior to finding this, you're using Windows files and folders. Well, files and folders are very linear in nature, whereas the type of information you have is much more of a database style. You want to be able to query it and see it in different ways and different, other than just a linear flow of, oh, it's in that, that's a file and a folder and a folder and a folder. So it became very cumbersome to try to make sure you had all the right information in one place, to the point where most businesses just got tired of trying to systemize their operations. So this tool here, I'll show you a little bit about it, but so if we go into managing the work as a key function, we've got this broken down into sub-functions. So finance, external accounting, run the Lethbridge Water Ski Club through there, as you can see. Inventory management, IT, all of our admin, human resources, safety. So these are all processes that we have developed. So as an example, so something like payroll. We had a situation where our office manager slipped on the ice. It's getting to be probably 4 years ago now when we had that freak ice storm. Slipped on the ice, hit her head, has not returned to work since. So it was a payroll day. And so I went in here and started following the work plans. So we have work plans on how to prepare for payroll, how to enter it into QuickBooks, how to calculate after hours pay. All of these are individual work plans. So processing payroll in QuickBooks as an example, all of the 24 steps that it takes are there. But what's nice about this and the software tool of it is that you need to ensure that all hours are entered on a timesheet. Entered on timesheet is blue, which means it's linked to another process. So nowhere in here have we ever duplicated the information that we've written. So when you click on that, it's a hyperlink that takes you to another process, so you're not ever rewriting things. What you want to be able to do is have information once, because one thing that we know for sure is that everything in here is going to change all the time. So that's the biggest frustration of people trying to capture their processes. So I want to show you this to give you an idea of just how involved it gets in all the processes it takes to run a business.
So So Brent, all those links come when you actually got the EMIS software.
Oh, sorry, let me get back to that, sorry. So the folks that were doing the consulting for EMIS, they were challenged because all of these clients, they kept telling them what they needed to do, but they knew that their clients weren't having success because they were trying to use Windows and files and folders. So a couple of them broke away and developed this. It's called Touchstone. So they broke away and created this software. And so it's the, now you've got what you should be doing. Now this software actually provides a reasonable how to do it. So yeah, so they broke off and formed this. And so it's what's really interesting about the eMyth is it talks about how do you free yourself from your business. A lot of folks here will, ultimately the goal is to either sell or have a business make money when you're not there. You can be on the beach somewhere and your business is making money. It's not something that I think you go into the business expecting in the first year or five, but it really your exit out of the business as well as your flexibility and the benefit of owning a business should be a priority. I don't think it needs to be there year one. This is a look down the road a little bit. Once you have some of these things in place, you can reasonably see how you could step away from your business and you're not, oftentimes it's called tribal knowledge, right? Knowledge is passed through the tribe at a very slow rate, and so when you want to try to learn how to do payroll, which is all of these processes, you just don't learn it overnight. So the next person learning it is going to take notes and be trained by somebody if you're lucky enough to have the overlap, which is not always there. So I came in and did payroll and just followed. It took me a lot longer than it would have taken her, but it got done, which is not possible in many other businesses that I know of.
So this software that you have, this Touchstone.
Yes.
Who was the person that dumped all your data into there? Was that
it just
you,
your,
yeah, right.
Yeah. Over about 5
just
years.
Like our thousands,
a few thousand
of
hours.
Yeah,
it takes,
right?
It's a huge commitment.
Yeah.
However, it's once people get used to it, it's not that, when somebody knows how to do it, and it's way easier just to do it rather than try to record it. So we invested, that's where I come in and hold that level of accountability, right? That's kind of my role around there, is to say, okay, is this in Touchstone? How do I know? So when I come in on the weekend and the answering machine somehow got erased and we have emergency calls that are not being handled properly, I need to be able to go in here and hit search, and hit answering machine, answer, type on here, search, processes, answering machine, script, outgoing recording, re-record the outgoing recording because it got deleted somehow, right?
Yeah.
So something as random as that, that is a big deal to come up with that script and make sure you got all the points about this isn't recording, this is emergency service, this is what, you can't miss things in that case, right? You can become liable. So something as simple as that, it's all there. So the other tools that are there that I think make this a really neat application, work plans are going to be your procedures and whatever terminology, workflows that you want to use, kind of the details. Then checklists are going to be something that's very quick hit. It's also a management tool as well, so it's linked back to the individuals. You can upload files and templates, so if you want your meeting notes and your reminders and different things, you can have the templates right there. You can create forms, you can write policy in here, and then you have video and audio as well, which is a really cool tool for communicating. Sometimes it's better to have screenshots and click through something and in a video type format, so those are all there as well.
Purchase or
this is a membership. This is monthly. Yeah. It's a cloud-based. Yeah.
Is it vary with how much how big your business is?
A little bit with users. Yeah, the number of users. Rough. I think it's $150 right now US per month. So it's not going to be something you're going to come out of the gates doing. But what you will find is down the road you're going to say, what was that software? Because this is becoming a real pain. Your tendency in business is to write things down so that you can, at very minimum, insulate your business a little bit from turnover. And McDonald's is a great example of how they can have turnover and they can train somebody and hit the floor very quickly and very accurately and produce very consistent results without the skill set that's required there is fairly minimum as well. So
I think the key to here is what he's showing you is he's been working on the business, not in the business. What he's got there separates his veterinarian clinic's value compared to others that go by the seat of their pants or good marriage.
We had an interested buyer, and it's not confidential, I don't think, but it's we're not interested in selling that business, but there's kind of a feeding frenzy right now in all industries where, like pharmacies and different things, there's like growth by acquisition is a very inevitable trend in capitalism. So the bigger companies just want to keep growing, and they grow by buying up entities that represent the same type of business. So the one company that was looking at it, I think, owns 800 and some vet clinics now, and their parent company is Mars Chocolate Bars. But they walked through and they looked at things like the server room, how in order is the data and the security of the server room. Is it something that's a dusty corner that's not well kept, or is it organized and can you follow a cable from one piece of equipment to another? They looked at how dependent is the business on the owners, because when you sell a business, they'll stipulate whether you can leave tomorrow or in 2 years or 5 years, depending on the risk and the confidence they have in what you're doing. So this kind of thing starts to play into the value of the business, whether you stay or go. But it also makes it nice to be away from the business and skiing and doing things where you can afford to do that. And everybody in your business can do that. It's not just that the owners can take off, but everybody's backstopped, which is nice.
So if you sold this, would you buy this and her motorhome then, or just one?
See, the plan of the motorhome is for her and the kids to travel all summer. So the lucky thing is I don't have to be in it or drive it. So, so everything's tied back to an org chart as well, which I don't want to. I think we can move on right now. We're ready to switch over. But so you click on our bookkeeper role as an example. All of the processes that are linked back to them are tied to the org chart as well. So it's pretty slick, and you can use it as a management tool too. So all the checklists are active. If somebody wants to confirm that the cleaners, the after-hour third-party cleaners that come in at night, have completed everything, they log in with their own login and say, yep, yeah, I cleaned this, and they check everything off, and then the manager gets a note saying that it's been checked off. So. Any questions on that?
I just can't believe more businesses don't have that. Just experiencing, I even have this last year and a half job that I've been, the person I was covering for was supposed to be relieved. Last year, then figure it out yourself. Nobody knows what she did or how she did. It's been a very stressful year.
Yeah, if anybody's good at writing processes and is logical and organized and a gold personality type or whatever you want to call yourself, and you want to scrap your business plan and join mine, let me know, because someone that can come in and come alongside them and help them write it, because who in their busy day has time to record all of that while they're doing it, right? That's the biggest pitfall with software like this, is you have to make a commitment. It's got to get worse before it gets better, right? So, operations, getting, doing, managing, limited resources. It's always going to be a juggling act. The wheel, the spoke analogy, got to have the spokes the same length. If you're fantastic at getting work and you can't keep up with doing work, it's a rough ride. Similarly, if you're not able to manage the work, it really the wheels start to fall off in a big way. Most importantly, though, manage the work. Chris, any questions? I think that's it. We're gonna move on to location. Good.
Thank you, Brent. Learned a lot today. Also learned about my vocabulary. Rubric is not English. We will now have a 15-minute break, and then we'll hear from Ashley Solms from Agusea. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Tim's is closed.
Thank you.
about Ashley. She joined the Abbasi Young team in the Lethbridge office in November 2013. She's advanced up to the position of associate, and she works in office sales and leasing. And so she finds the best deals for her customers in the maximum space, the best cost, that she's going to present to us on location analysis. So we'll pass it off to Ashley now and give her a round of applause here.
Real estate about 5 years ago, I was in Australia running a restaurant, so there's not a whole lot of correlation there. I had zero knowledge, nothing that had to do anything with this presentation, but I've learned it, so I think that you guys can too. All in all, commercial real estate refers to land or buildings where the owner wants to generate some sort of a profit from it. So even if you are occupying your business in a space and you own that space, your business is still paying your investment money. So you're generating a profit from it. As a broker, I personally specialize in the office sector with a little bit of retail. But what I do is I facilitate transactions, whether it's lease or sales, in the commercial sector. So I cannot sell a house. Don't ask me to. I'm allowed to, but I can't. I wouldn't even know where to start. So this is our team at Abbasi Young. So our broker, Doug, he manages our team. Doug, Jeremy, and Kendall, they all own the brokerage. Then there's four of us associates, Josh, Jaden, myself, and Binko. And then Jordan is a property manager, and Jim is our appraiser. So we kind of facilitate all facets of the real estate transaction. So what is my job? There's three main parts of it. There's sales, there's cost evaluation, and there's project managing. So part of my job in order to get people interested is I need to network and do things like this and get my face out there. And it's probably one of the scariest parts of the job for me, but it's what enables the rest of my job to be successful. So from that, we take prospects that become interested in space, whether you guys have a space that you're interested in or someone calls us based on the phone number that they saw. We put deals together with landlords that we know, and then we start negotiations. From there, we determine the market value. So when we deal with the landlord, they say, oh, I don't know what my property's worth, but I'd like to lease it out. So we generate those values based on past transactions. And then we can calculate what their returns look like for their investment and what sort of lease values we need to get from the tenants to pay those returns. And then from there, after negotiations happen, there's a lot of due diligence that needs to happen. So if someone's purchasing a building, they need to get, you know, environmental reports, like these ladies were talking about. There's a lot that goes into that, you know. If a gas station was on your site prior to you wanting to buy this building, there's going to be soil issues, most likely, and it's going to make your building less valuable. All the way down to, like, removing conditions in an offer to lease. If someone needs to remove a condition to get their financing. So you find a space, then you go to your bank and you say, hey, I have this space. Do you approve it? You get your finance approved, then you remove that condition, you can move forward with the transaction. Everybody's been talking about leasehold improvements, that takes a huge factor in renting a space. So what someone goes in and expect that they can turn a 1,500 square foot space into a kitchen and a little restaurant and they think it'll cost them $50,000, they're probably looking at upwards of $250,000 to do that. There's so many different areas where you just don't think about health codes that's required to be able to turn around a space. And then we go into the actual improving of the space. So construction timelines and costs, it always takes longer than what they tell you. And if you can't budget for that, then you need to wait a little longer before you initiate that transaction. And so all of that has to go along with my job, dealing with the city, getting those permits. There's a lot of back and forth, and there's a lot of little hidden treasures and costly aspects of it as you go through the process. So evaluating your needs. Like some people were talking, there's, you know, do you need space? That's a big question, because as you start out, not every business needs space. You can work from your home. You can work in co-working spaces. Like, for example, the port, they're opening up. We're working on Westport right now, so we'll have a west side option. And so trying to expand that co-working atmosphere, because it cuts your costs down. Like, if you want to rent an individual office, you're looking at minimum $500 a month, generally. And a co-working membership is about $200. You have a space to work every single day of the week. So it's fostering that collaboration between different business lines as well that help your performance and your bottom line. So generally talking about a location, if you're a retail business, you need some real estate, because it's really hard to sell something if you don't have somewhere for people to come to, unless you're doing it at markets, things like that, where you pop up your shop and then you go from there. So if you're in the industrial sector, you can generally work out of your garage for a little bit and then process into getting a small retail space or a small industrial space after that. It doesn't need to happen right away, because it's so costly to have real estate and it's a huge commitment. So I know that everyone's super committed to their plan and their idea and their business, but at the end of the day, time will tell if it's going to be successful or not. So if you sign a 10-year lease on a space and your business goes flop, you're still committed to that 10-year lease, and that can ruin a lot, because a lot of landlords will ask for things like personal guarantees, which are the scariest thing in the world, because if you're going to guarantee a 10-year lease, they're going to take your house away at the end of the day if you can't pay it. And so, I don't want to do that. real estate can be super expensive, and it's inflexible, so you need to understand how much space you need today, tomorrow, and 10 years down the road. You don't want to limit yourself, but you don't want to buy a loaf of bread and eat one piece out of it every month and then throw the rest away. So you want to be able to utilize everything that you're paying for. You want to figure out what you're going to do in your space, how many people you're going to employ, how many offices you need, or, you know, if you're running an automobile company, how many cars do you need to fit in that garage in order to make your business successful? If you can do it with one car in that garage and generate enough income, you know, per square foot, then that's great. If you need four, then don't buy a space that only can fit one, right? It's pretty basic, but it's evaluating your total business before making that real estate decision. Coming up with a range on what you can afford. So if you're opening up a retail business and you want to be in the mall and you're expected to pay $60, $70 a square foot, and you can afford, you know, $10,000 for a small space in the mall, that's great. But you probably need to be Lululemon right off the bat to be able to afford that. So you might need to start on going to a smaller space or not as popular of a space and focus on your marketing in order to generate business and exposure for your company to succeed, and then generate enough income where you can get to those better locations where you see more traffic. And then what location will suit my business? I'm not gonna stick a high-end restaurant in the middle of the industrial park, right? I'm not going to stick a manufacturing facility like Maple Leaf in the mall. You know, it just doesn't work. You need to figure out where you're going to see your right customer base and where they're going to find themselves at the end of that day. Any questions so far? Perfect. Okay, so there's a couple things to consider. The city puts out a great map every year. They generate traffic counts. So every street in the city, from downtown all the way to the outskirts, it shows how many cars pass there. So for a retail business or any business that you need actual exposure, it's really good to look at these traffic counts just to see how many people are driving past your business, seeing your sign at the end of the day. They may not stop today or tomorrow, but next week they'll think of you or they'll tell someone because they've seen you. So that's why you see Mayor McGrath Drive or Third Ave. Those lease rates are higher because of the exposure that they receive. Your neighbors. So if you're opening up, for example, a kid's store, not your neighbors.
Sorry.
Some neighbors that you have won't help your business, or they'll make it worse, or they'll make it better. If you're opening up a kid's store and you're next to a Love to Play, like a kid's play store, and a family restaurant, and a dentist office, and you want to open a kid's clothing store, you're going to be successful because a lot of the people coming to that area are going to also be your customers. So you can piggyback off of their marketing, their customers, and supply those people with all service sort of solution. Access. If people can't get to you, they don't want to try to figure it out. So you need to make it as easy as possible. If you're an office space and you just have your own office employees working for you, then getting up to the 11th floor of Lethbridge Center is not a problem, right? They're coming there. But to tell, you know, your average person that, oh, we're here or there, it needs to be easy. You need to have a straight line on how to get to your space. Otherwise, people just won't do it. Parking is the biggest concern in downtown Lethbridge. So a lot of businesses don't necessarily need to be in downtown, but right now we have a parking crisis because the city just shut down two lots out of four. And so now all of the parking meters are being used right now. So if you count on traffic of people coming to your business, you need to make sure they have somewhere to park, as well as your employees need somewhere to park. And parking is also an added expense. So it's something that you need to consider that you may pay for your employees, yourself, or finding a location that offers a parking lot that's reserved for that space in itself. Signage is expensive, but it's worth it. But it still needs to be visible. You know, you need to put it in the right places. A lot of buildings, like for example, the Lethbridge Center, unless you're a super high class tenant, you're not allowed to put signs on that building. So if you're counting on being able to throw a big sign across your windows on the 8th floor, they're not gonna allow it. So it's finding out what restrictions the landlord is going to give you for signage options on the building. And sometimes they're willing to pay for the install if they want it to abide by their guidelines, but most of the time the cost is on you to install it, design it, get it all done, and then the landlord still needs to approve it at the end of the day. Interior improvements. Again, this will repeat itself throughout the whole presentation, but it is costly. Like, just to put down some flooring, it's not like going to Home Depot and grabbing some vinyl plank for $1.99. It needs to be commercial grade if you're going to have traffic through the area. So it ends up being quite costly. People underestimate those costs because they think it's a bathroom reno in their house, and it's not. It's the standards that apply to commercial spaces are sometimes absolutely outrageous, but they need to happen. You know, handicap accessible bathrooms. If you're in an old building and you need to install a hood fan for your restaurant, you may be dealing with asbestos, right? So it's, once you touch it, you have to fix it. And that's not fun either, because you're fixing old problems that aren't necessarily yours, but you've taken them on. So getting contractors to give you as many quotes as possible, evaluating what contractor is quoting you for, because, you know, you say, I need a handicap accessible bathroom. Well, one contractor is going to say, well, you need this and this and this, and the other one's like, well, this is what the city requires, this is what we're doing. So you want to be able to compare those quotes and make sure you're getting the right product at the end of the day for the best dollar. And then it comes down to purchase or lease. Right now, purchasing is a little popular in the sense of you get to own your space, you get to make the decisions, but lending rates are, well, they're going up now, but they were quite low for quite a while, which made it easier for people to purchase. So over the term of a long lease, you've more than paid for the purchase of your building. So it's an option for some people. Cost analysis. So like I was saying, with a purchase, you generally need about 20 to 25% down unless you go through a lending company that's willing to do lower. You know, if you're a Subway, they're gonna pretty much give you the money and say, take it, run with it, we don't need anything down, we know you're gonna be successful. The more risky the business, the more they generally wanna see down or see a pretty expansive business plan to support what you're doing in order to give you that financing. The payment works very similar to a house mortgage, so you can have it included where all your taxes is included in that, but then you're still responsible for the maintenance on it. If your house roof blows off or gets a leak or whatever, you're responsible to fix it just as you are in your commercial building. Current lenders are aggressive, so the cost has lowered, or it's on the rise now, but it was extremely low to borrow before. Lease costs. This is probably the most popular one and the most in-depth that you can get, in the sense of there's a lot of hidden costs. So once you sign an offer to lease, you're required to give a first and last month's deposit, and before you even remove your conditions. So before you even get your financing approved, you need to have that deposit. So you can't count on the bank to give you that deposit money for the most part. That needs to come out of pocket, and it gets held in a trust account until you remove your conditions. If you choose not to remove your conditions, you get that money back. You need to assess how long you want to lease for, how long you can afford to lease for in a location before you feel like you need to expand or move out. So there's different terms that different companies or landlords will take on. Some will do month to month, which is super rare, but most landlords like to see 3 to 5 year terms, which is, you know, it shows your confidence in your business when you can go in and say, yeah, I'd love to sign a 5 year term. The landlord looks at it and says, well, they're confident to be able to be here that long, so we're confident in signing them on as well. The landlord is responsible for the building, the maintenance, taxes, maintenance, insurance. That's generally what your triple net refers to, if you can see a little bit below. Additional rent, triple net, operating costs, CAM, they're all the same thing. It's something that confuses a lot of people, but they all refer to your taxes, your maintenance, insurance. On occasion, for buildings that aren't separately metered, for instance, the Lethbridge Center, there's not 500 different electricity meters in that building, your utilities will be included in that triple net cost. And that's just, they take the whole building's square footage, they take the cost, and they divide it up per square foot. Everybody owes $1.50 for their utilities, and they put that into your additional rent cost. You can negotiate tenant improvements upon signing a lease. The landlord generally, it just has to make sense. The landlord needs to see that money back over time, or they need to see the value that you're putting into the building to see that if you leave in 1 year, that that building's leasable with the improvements that you've put in. So if someone decides to put a restaurant space and build out a restaurant for that $300,000 that's it's gonna cost, the landlord's willing to put some money towards that, not all of it, because at the end of the day, restaurants are popular in Lethbridge and everyone wants a restaurant space that's completely built out, and they don't want to have to pay that $300,000 themselves. So their space is very rentable after that money's being put in. Lease payments are tax deductible, so talk to your accountant. I am not one. Don't ask me about it. I have no idea how that works, but your accountant will know. So when you look at a brochure and it says $10 per square foot plus your additional rent, it involves a lot more. So a brochure may say $10 per square foot, your additional rent is $5 per square foot, plus your utilities and GST. So how you need to evaluate that business and what your monthly rent looks like is it's $15 per square foot times your square footage divided by 12 months of the year. So when people they're like, oh my goodness, it's gonna cost me $30,000 to rent my space every month. No. It's $30,000 a year, but it seems ridiculous, but we get that question all the time. You still have to pay for your utilities if it's not included in the triple net. So most spaces will be separately metered. You pay for what you use, and then you have to pay GST on everything. So even in the process of signing an offer to lease, if the space isn't zoned properly for your use, you're going to have to pay for a change of use. If the space doesn't have enough parking allocation, we're going to need to get a waiver from the city for additional parking. Permits cost money, whether it's for occupancy, a building permit, your HVAC permit, all of those things cost a lot of money. Anytime you want to touch electrical, the city needs to approve it first. It's not like your house where you own it, you can do whatever you want. The city needs to make sure that the public can occupy the space in a safe manner. And that's why they have their codes and regulations. Does anyone work for the city here? You do?
No, I
it's tough. You know what? I mean, a lot of the fight that real estate agents go through is with city regulations and just getting past these hurdles that most people don't think about. So it can be fun. So the city does a really good job of providing us with property maps, property types. So there's four main categories. You deal with industrial, commercial, residential, and public. From those types, when you deal with mostly commercial and industrial, you have, in my area of expertise, there's industrial, retail, office, investment, and land. So that's everything that our Avis and Young deals with. We do not deal with anything residential unless it's like 20 apartment buildings and it's investment purchase at the end of the day. But then you can go to this map that the city provides. You can zoom in as much as you want, and it'll tell you how each property is zoned. There's different maps for different things. You can get tax assessment maps, which if you own a house, you can find your house on there, figure out what your taxes are. But that's all available on the city website. But we utilize this tool quite a bit because if we're selling a property in Coaldale, they don't have this. We have to look at old archives or call the city, and that's a pain in the butt. And so it's really nice that we're provided with these tools that the city's given us. So most of the properties that we deal with are general commercial. So this is where a change of use would come into play. If you wanted to open up a church on a general commercial, you would need to apply for an allowance of religious assembly to be added to this list. So right now you can open up a fitness facility, a hotel, you know, there's all these permitted uses, and then comes a second category of discretionary uses, so that you still need to get approval from the city for this use. So when you find the zoning of a space that you're interested in, and it says that your use isn't on there, it's under discretionary, the city still needs to send out a letter to everyone in the area and have them say yay or nay to your use. So we're going to deal a lot with that in the future with the cannabis industry coming in. So the city's going to be backlogged, with a lot of requests for that. People can say no to almost anything if it's not on the list that it's being zoned for. So you can't just pop up a retail store in the middle of a residential area. They'll say no because there's probably not enough parking.
Does that mean unanimous, or is it just like majority?
So what they do is there's a process to it. I believe they have to put something out in the Herald saying this business is interested. If there's residential, like if it's in a residential area, they need to send it, make sure that everybody in that area is known about it. And then that person could go anonymously to the city. But I don't know how often that happens, because I really do feel like not a lot of people read the paper and pay attention to their specific area and what's coming in. But we don't really see a lot of retail components opening up in the middle of Copperwood, right? So.
A letter sent out to what? Each?
To each household.
Residence.
Yeah, in that area. For the most part, I believe. All the time. Okay, so industrial, this is just some facts. The spaces generally start around 1,500 square feet for about $1,200 a month. This is your lowest cost to rent space. Your average lease rate is about $750. Your price to buy is $132 per square foot. This is on average. This particular building is really nice, so it would cost more. But industrial has a range of how they're built. Often they're built very basically. Now they're starting to be built up with nice offices in the front with some retail areas, and then all the manufacturing happens in the back. So it just depends on what the use is that you're going for. Office space is your mid price point. So you're about $1,450 per square foot in the downtown area and $17 in the suburban area. For instance, where A1 Insurance is now, they're doing a pretty amazing space there. In the sense that they're kind of increasing those rates in the suburban areas because they're offering a lot of amenities. So it makes it more enticing for businesses to go to those spaces where there's collaboration. I think that you can get more out of your income at the end of the day if you're surrounded by the right people just by cross business. Up until a couple years ago, you couldn't really purchase office space. You would have to build your own office building. You couldn't just purchase your own space that you could operate your office in. But now some landlords are starting to condo buildings there, and what that means is they'll take a 3-4 building, or however many floors, and they can divide it up, and as long as it's fire rated properly and they offer a certain common area, they can condo that building so that you can purchase just your space. And that's exciting for a lot of people, like doctors, people like that, that they know they're going to be in a space for a long time, and now they want to own it, and then they can sell it when they want to retire one day. And so they're investing in themselves just for their own space. But this is new. Retail is extremely expensive. If you want to rent at a place like Crossings, you're at $35 a square foot plus your operating costs, which are generally around $14 in that area. So $14, $13, you're about $48 per square foot. which is really high when you consider that your industrial space is under 10. So you're really paying for your surroundings, the traffic counts that come to the area, but it can go all the way down to about $14 per square foot in different areas of downtown or outskirts, small suburb, little retail locations. But it's definitely the highest cost. You know, if you're in the mall, some of the mall stores pay $100 a square foot. It's really, really expensive, but you're pretty much most likely going to be successful in the mall if you have a decent concept because you're going to see enough traffic. We value things. I mean, we keep track of all our stats. These are available, I believe, on our website. We put out a couple reports a year. To give you background on the Lethbridge Market, I write about 3 to 4 reports on the Lethbridge Market every year, and they're the most boring reports in the world because our economy is so nice and stable compared to other areas of Canada and southern Alberta. So because we're egg-based, we've stayed steady. We see a little bit of fluctuation, but nothing compared to the Calgary market. I was talking with a gentleman today, and he's a broker in Calgary, and he said, I just leased out 45,000 square feet for $2 a square foot. So can we do something like that here? I said, no. No. There's a reason why we have very little vacancy in Lethbridge compared to other markets. And so we expect the returns that vacancy, you know, it becomes us, you know. Our vacancy rate, for instance, in the Lethbridge Center, which is the biggest office building, is about 500,000 square feet, is 5%. And, you know, you talk about those, what we've heard from Calgary, the downtown market, you know, you're over 50% vacancy in those buildings. And so, yeah, you can do lease rates at $2 a square foot just to get people in there paying your taxes, your maintenance, your insurance, so it's not costing you to run your building. So the lady that runs the Lethbridge Center and I had a good laugh about $2 a square foot today. This is just not possible. As for transaction valuations, it's really even in Lethbridge right now. Our industrial investment, office, retail, and land sector are all pretty much on par with each other in terms of valuation, not in terms of square footage. Square footage you can't compare as easily as the valuation that comes out of it. Does anyone have any questions before I get into the process? I swear I'm almost done. Oh, I haven't been going for long at all. Okay, so when someone calls and they say, hey, I really need 3,000 square feet of office space, I need to start writing things down as soon as they say that. So I want to find out a couple things when someone calls me. So when you guys are looking for your real estate, you want to know a couple things before you call an agent or before you start looking. You want to know what your budget is, how much space you need. If you don't know how much space, that's okay because we can show you different spaces that will be able to determine how much you will need out of what you're seeing. I need their contact information, otherwise I can't get them any information. And then kind of what sort of business that they're looking at. If someone says to me, I really want to open a pharmacy at College Center, I'm going to say there's no way Shoppers is going to let you do that. So we need as much information as possible, not to say no to everything, but just not to leave, so you're not led down a road that there's a big fat no at the end. So. Yeah, that's a prospect. From there, we take what they've given us and what we've generated from the call, and we create a bit of a market survey. So these are all comparable properties, and we present them so that you can compare them easily by looking across the sheet. You know, your property name, your address, square footage, the lease rate that they're asking, the additional rent, and sort of what that includes, your total per month, what sort of parking you're dealing with, and any little notes on the building that may be relevant to this tenant. From there, the tenant will look at that and hopefully they can, this was 14 options or whatever that was, hopefully they can narrow down to a handful because tours take a long time and if you're touring 14 properties, we're looking at a couple days. So we range for a tour. So for the most part, any listing that we have the keys in the office. We can tour any time for the most part. But we go take a drive around. We look at the neighbors. We look at the access points. We look at the parking. We look at all of those things that we talked about before to make sure that all of these things will suit your needs. Lots of people like to go to the space at different times of the day to see like when the traffic is the highest, and that helps determine their business hours as well. And then we eliminate options that don't work. And then we can go forward with hopefully one or two options and narrow down that ask. From there, we write an offer. Hopefully it's all one space because it was absolutely perfect, and hopefully we can get it for a great rate, but we're not living in a dream world. Some people offer on multiple spaces at once and wait for the landlords to come back. And you always offer with conditions. So you're not always trapped into an offer as soon as you sign on the paper. So different conditions can be leasehold improvements. If you want to ask the landlord, say, hey, I need you to invest $20,000 into this space in order to make this financially work for me. If the landlord sees the value in it, he may say yes to that. Another condition can be financing. I need to make sure that I can get my business off the ground, and the bank's going to say, yep, we'll give you a loan. So we'll have a financing condition. Some people, you know, if you're purchasing a space, or if you're doing a long lease, or if it's a large lease, or if it's extensive, some people want lawyer approval. So they want their lawyer to look it over and make sure that this makes sense. You know, in every contract that we do, I say I'm not a lawyer, I'm not an accountant, I'm not any business advisor. If you have anyone that you want to contact, take this with you and make sure that you're making the right decision, because it's a huge commitment. So we can get, you know, board approval if you're dealing with the board, different things like that. So it enables you to move forward into negotiations without showing all your cards right at the front. And then we talk about timing, pricing. We present the offer to the landlord, and then we negotiate the details. Conditions. So yeah, like I was talking about, there's lots of different conditions that we put in. One of the biggest ones is city approval. So I don't know if you're aware, but the House of Ham Consignment Boutique, they went up at the old Dimnick Law Office downtown. And that law office was zoned strictly for office use. And the city was not on board to change that use whatsoever. So what that lady is doing is she's operating a home business, and she literally lives upstairs. So she can't ever move out of that space. Because it'll no longer be a home office. And so it's a little bit of a unique situation, but we have to be creative to get these approvals. There's another building that's over by the casino, and this gentleman's operating a denture clinic, and he's classified as a medical use. And the city needs 12 parking stalls for his use. Well, there's only 20 parking stalls for the whole building, but he doesn't have anybody coming to him. He's literally making dentures all day, so we need to be creative in the other spaces, uses for the other businesses going into that building. So being creative in dealing with the city is fun, but we always put a city condition on there of city approvals. Permits, whatever it has to do with the city, we need those city approvals before we remove the conditions. Otherwise, you're stuck leasing a space and the city won't even let you open at the end of the day. Then we make improvements and move in. So as long as your cost of construction was satisfactory, you're able to pay that guy to do all the work, and hopefully he did it in the right time frame, and you're not paying 5 months extra on your loan before you're even open for business, hopefully everything went smoothly and you're opening for business. But it's not always as smooth. There's a lot of little hidden costs, like I've said. Just be aware of everything and read everything over and have other people read it over for you, because when we do an offer to lease, it's a good document, but there's a lot in it that's not understandable right off the bat. So there's a lot to learn. Does anyone have any questions?
Maybe not necessarily a question, but a comment. And one of the things we see over and over again are people who come in for financing and they bring us they've already leased the space. They don't know if they're going to get funding. And so I don't know if they so believe that that is the only space in the world that will ever work for them, and they go in and they sign it, and they're so far off the mark. So I mean, and then the financing takes a while.
Yeah.
And then you start to work with them, and quite often you just go, that's really probably not the best location. So is that?
Yeah, we deal with that all the time. So the funny thing about getting financing is, in order to finish your business plan, you need to have a location that you present to the bank. So, or that's what banks like from us, or from these businesses. So the bank says, I want to see your business plan, I want to see your location, I want to see what that location offers you, I want to make sure that this business is going to work for you, or this and that we're going to give you this money. So a lot of people end up talking to us halfway through their business plan process, which is, and then they often sign offers to lease, which is too fast. So you could sign an offer to lease, and that's why you base it pending financing. You know, you need to add that condition in there. And these conditions don't need to be removed in a day or two. They can be removed in a month or two if necessary, right? We can extend these conditions. It doesn't need to happen so fast. But it doesn't hurt to figure out your location if you've determined that you need a location, but just don't remove all your conditions and start paying rent before you have your financing or your business sorted out, right?
So don't be afraid to have conditions, thinking that if you have a condition that the landlord is going to turn it down.
Yeah.
Protect yourself.
Every landlord pretty much expects conditions because it's the smart way to go about your business, right? You're not going to go sign something and then find out that the city won't let you open or that you can't get your financing. You need those conditions. The landlord wants you to be successful at the end of the day because they want to receive the rent money. So there's always a happy medium to the situations where the landlord's happy and the tenant's happy to pay what they're paying, the landlord's receiving what they're receiving. I think, otherwise people are out to lunch. Any other questions? Does anyone here rent or own commercial real estate? How are your guys' experiences? Did you determine your sale value before you? Yeah, good. So landlords can get a little skeezy sometimes, and they can say, oh yeah, my building right now is worth $200,000, but if you guys are gonna put $200,000 in it, then it's worth $400,000 at the end of the day. So you've double paid your own renovations. So if you do have an option to purchase your building after 5 years or even 10 years or even the first right of refusal to purchase it, try to determine that value before you try to execute that purchase. Because, yeah, all of a sudden this area is bopping and the location is great and there's so much traffic and now the property has increased in value and now you're paying for what you did to the property. And that's not fun. So, we deal with that. Yeah.
The landlord's insurance isn't the same as the person who's leasing's insurance.
No, so that's another good remark. The landlord's insurance covers the building and its structure, flood damage, you know, anything on the outside of the walls. Your insurance covers your contents and your liability. So if you run a restaurant, you need a high liability insurance. If someone chokes or slips or burns themselves, or, you know, there's lots of things that come with different liability insurance. If you're operating an office space, your liability insurance is super low because you just have a couple employees and they know how to work in the space. You're not dealing with the public. But yeah, so in that additional rent cost is that taxes, maintenance, insurance. That's a number that the landlord cannot make money on. So when they say plus triple net, it is what it is. So it's literally the taxes for the building, the insurance that they have to pay on the building, and the maintenance. So whether there's landscaping involved or some siding needs to be replaced or something, it's throughout the year. And so they need to show you a statement at the end of the year of how that money was allocated. If it was not all used, say they say it's charged $6 per square foot of additional rent, and at the end of the year they only used $5.80 per square foot, landlord has to cut you a check. If they used $6.01, you have to pay them for the additional that it costs. So generally the landlords will inflate that price right off the bat just by 10 cents, 20 cents, but then they're happier to cut you a check at the end of the year than to try to get money out of you. No business person likes an unexpected expense, and so the landlord will take that into account and understand that if it costs me less, I'm giving the money back. Any other questions? Oh, whichever one, sorry. You go ahead. Yeah.
Well, how does the
built to suit options, or yeah. So for example, if you're looking at a space, let's say Heritage, you know, there's that new building there, and there's 1,500 square feet on the main floor, and you want to open up a orthotics spot, you know, where you have a couple offices, a lunchroom. So that is a build-to-suit. So the landlord will say, yep, we'll build that up to your specifications as long as it makes sense and we're happy with that cost. But the lease rate will be indicative of those improvements. So if we invest $100,000 into the space, and originally we were asking $20 per square foot, if you're going to sign for 5-year term, we need to see that $100,000 put back into the lease rate. So at least you don't have to come up with all that cost right up front. It'll be progressively paid. A lot of times the landlord will want to see some sort of extra out of it. So if you're, I can't do the numbers in my head, but you might end up paying $20, $25 per square foot instead over the term of 10 years, and the landlord would hope to make some interest off of that money they originally spent on you. But it makes it easier for you to get off your feet, but make sure you make that calculation of what that extra $5 per square foot does over the term of 10 years, because if he's investing $100,000 and that $5 per square foot ends up equaling $250,000, think about getting a loan instead and not doing it that way through the landlord, because he's getting an extra $150,000 just for doing that for you. So, thank you.
One of our participants asked, is there a Landlord-Tenant Act for commercial properties?
Yes. So there's the whole real estate council. It's the Real Estate Council of Alberta. They govern everything that we do. That's why our contracts are not 2 pages, they're 9 pages, because a lot of it is legal jargon. The way that we hold deposits need to be held in a trust account. They monitor that trust account to the penny. We need to show all our statements of everything, of every transaction that goes in and out. But then there's also, just like for residential, you can contact RECA if you have any issues. If landlords and tenants can't come to an agreeable solution, often the problem will go to what's called arbitration. And so, say for example, you had an option to renew on a 5-year lease at market rates. Landlord says this space is worth $25. Tenant says, no, I've been paying $6 for the last 5 years. It's now not all of a sudden worth $25. What happens is that situation goes to arbitration, and the real estate council will determine what market value is, and that's what has to be paid. So there is a governing body. You know, if the landlord needs to come after someone because they've ditched on rent and they're saying see you later, they often go through RECA to try to facilitate that. And then it's also how we get our insurance as a brokerage. So if we mess up huge, which we don't, we go through them for insurance.
Any advice on, or is it a service that Abson Young or other realtors would offer? It's because we always hear the stories about, okay, I was quoted X number of dollars on renovations, on leaseholds. Is it a service that you would provide if somebody came to you and said, this is what I've been quoted? Does this make sense?
Yeah, so naturally we do that because you become quite close to the tenants as you guide them through these processes. The majority of the people we deal with have often never done this before, no real estate transaction is the same. So, for example, I've been doing a build-out project management for the last couple weeks, and do I know anything about construction? No, but I know enough common sense about it to say this isn't right, or get your butts in gear, this should have been done a long time ago, things like that. It's not really a service that we ask people to pay for, but it is something that you could get a project manager to do for you, right? We naturally do it, but at the end of the day, we're not responsible if the contractor doesn't finish your building within the time frame that you've requested, right? All we can do is give you advice on how to push them, or how to say, this quote doesn't make sense at the end of the day, or this is unnecessary, why are they quoting you for this? You don't want someone to take advantage of you for having lack of knowledge in the construction process. Or any of the process, really. It's good to have as many people look at those quotes and your contracts as possible. I don't think it's showing too much information ever. I think it's worth it to have as many opinions as you can, because different people will see different things. Thank you guys so much for having me.